the courage, I could say, to explore what they're exploring in their, again, fiction and nonfiction. Our writers are Chantel Acevedo, Adéwálé Àjàdí, Ananda Devi, Lola Shoneyin, and Véronique Tadjo. I'm Malaika Adero, and I live here in New York. I'm a longtime editor, cultural worker, and writer. My work as a book editor in corporate America is probably what I'm most known for. But I think more important than this occasion, I'm a passionate reader. And I can attest to the power of storytelling in my own life. Through literature, through stories, I've been able to extend way beyond the boundaries of my circumstance, really. Black, female, born and raised in the South, Knoxville, Tennessee. Christian, you know, the Bible Belt. I'm pretty much 20th century and an analog girl, you know, I've come into the 21st century, like most of us, kicking and screaming. But trying to break out of the mold and trying to be more than what I was told I could be in this society and in the world. And that's some of what I want to talk about here. One of the things that happens with to make gender or race or class a misery is isolation. And what stories and literature do is break down that isolation, again, allowing us to extend beyond boundaries that are set by other people. Our writers are, again, Chantel Acevedo, who's the author of The Distant Marvels, a novel just published last month. The female character at the center of this epic story reflects on her childhood during Cuba's Third War of Independence. She's born into a family of rebels and a mother who is as much a warrior in that struggle as anyone else. So for me, she explores the role of the woman in winning the struggles that have had to be won for independence, for freedom, for people in various parts of the world, and particularly in this case, Cuba. Adéwálé Àjàdí is the author of Omoluwabi 2.0, which is nonfiction, a very different kind of book from the rest, a narrative blueprint of sorts showing from a Nigerian perspective how traditional systems can be applied in the modern day to establish a more just society. Véronique Tadjo is the author of Queen Poku and the Shadow of Imana, Travels in the Heart of Rwanda. And her work is wonderful and amazing for the way in which she takes traditional legends and myths and kind of reworks them. She writes about Baale, female ancestor, Queen Abraha Puku, who's challenged to sacrifice her child for the good of the collective. You know, it made me reflect on being a young woman and watching movies where it always seems like, whether it was in the South Pacific or South America, there was a woman who would be called on to save the day. And she would often have to be a virgin, you know, and she would have to jump into a volcano or you know, throw her child into a volcano, you know. And so everyone would be saved by her actions but her, you know. And why is this, I wondered as a child. Again, why I turned to books and stories. Ananda Devi is the author of Indian Tango. And it's described as a hymn to female sensuality, to individual freedom, to understanding and companionship between the sexes around culture and religion. It is a sensual and a beautiful read that is so challenging as well as beautiful in the questions that it raises. And then Lola Shoneyin, I've had the pleasure of reading her The Secret Lives of Baba Sagi's Wives, which is brilliant, not only for this portrayal, for this look at humanity through the lens of polygamy, but in your use of humor, which I very much appreciate, because if we do not have humor in discussing issues of gender, we just won't survive. So I'm going to let the writers speak first. I would like for them to make to tell us about their work now, what they're doing now, and just what they want you to know about them at the outset of this conversation. And then I'll hop into the questions. Ananda?
Thank you, Malaika, and thank you all for being here. You've done a wonderful introduction, but also you've put the finger on the main issue, is that we don't have enough time to talk about all this very important question, and generally people don't think about them and talk about them enough. So, I mean, to start with, I'm originally from Mauritius, which is a small island in the Indian Ocean. And I've been writing in French since my childhood. So I started publishing when I was very young, when I was a teenager. So I'm mainly a novelist because I've published more novels than anything else. I've published about 12 novels, but also 4 collections of short stories and 3 books of poetry. So for me, genre is not gender, genre in French, but genre in the sort of form, literary form, is not something that encloses you, but that you sort of have to, that you use according to the mood you are in, or according to the theme that you're going to approach, which means that my novels are generally thought to be extremely intense, very often violent, and about issues that we'll be talking about today more in depth. Other than that, I'd say that I am concerned about violence generally, so there is an exploration of the origins of violence in the human being, how everybody has a kind of threshold, and that it's important to know that when you're seeing violence around you, it's not just somebody else performing an act of violence, but that one has to try to understand where that comes from and how it could be us. And that's the only way to try to diffuse violence, is to understand its origins first, and how anyone could be in any specific situation be pushed to that kind of violence. So for me, writing is about understanding first, understanding the other, and becoming the other in a way. That's the greatest pleasure of writing, is to be able to become so many other selves, I would say. It was the first way of escaping from my little island and the little village I came from in Mauritius. And I also think that writing is not about giving answers, but asking questions. And more importantly, it is the questions that we have to think about, and not answers coming to us, and that we have to take at face value. So I think that's what I have to say for myself.
Good evening, everyone. I have written 3 books of poems and 1 children's book, and my novel, The Secret Lives of Baba Sagi's Wives. When I was 14, I studied Lola Shoneyin's Lion and the Jaw. I don't know if anyone has read it. Well, there's a character there called Baruka, and I mean, he was such a pompous man. And he had all these women who were throwing themselves at him. He had so many wives. And I remember distinctly how horrified I was at 14 when I read that he would lift his arm and one of his wives would help him pluck the hairs. And that was all part of kind of looking after him as the husband, the wonderful man that they all worshipped. So that's one thing that happened when I was 14. The other important thing that, you'll understand where all this is going in a minute. The other thing is that my brother, one of my brothers had a girlfriend called Anne, and she was a medical student. And I think I was rather in love with her, mainly because she would come to our house and tell us all sorts of gory stories about some of the operations that she witnessed and had been involved in. I love these stories. I love the blood. I love the, you know, the tension. I loved everything. But on this particular occasion, she came and she said, you know, something happened last week. But before I tell you what happened last week, let me tell you what happened 2 weeks ago, because that's what actually led up to the events of last week. So I said, yeah, I'm all ears. And she told me this story about this man who had three wives, who had actually two wives, and had married a third, a university graduate. And after a few years, she was unable to conceive, and he dragged her so rudely and violently to the hospital and said, this girl can't give me children, what's all this about? And they started to investigate, and of course what they found was devastating for this entire family. And the minute I heard that story, I found it really interesting and I wanted to write it as a play. But of course I was still in school and not very dedicated to my writing. I would start write 2 pages and then not continue as you do when you're 14. But when I finally wrote my novel Harlots, which I couldn't find a publisher for, I then thought I'm gonna go back to that very story. And I did then write it, and it gave me an opportunity to explore all sorts of themes, aside from gender, also religion, the role of religion, the role that it plays within domestic situations, but also within my country as a whole. I'm totally fascinated with marriage, this institution that we continue to devote ourselves to, even though statistics show that we have failed miserably at actually making it work. And I also love the idea of polygamy. I found it really engaging, and the effects of polygamy on women, these are all issues that I sought to explore in my novel. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I come from a call and response culture, so I'll say good afternoon again. Good afternoon. Yeah, I hope you're all well. My name is Adéwálé Àjàdí. And the concept that drives my work is a concept called Molo. Molo is Yoruba for effective usage or fitness for purpose. So I'll tell you a story about my great-grandmother. My great-grandmother had 9 kids for 8 different husbands. She was not a slut. People did not disrespect her, because this is how women in my background in Ibadan actually created their relationship. So she would tell her, I stay with the husband as long as it was useful to me. Once it stops being useful, I move on. My grandmother, on the other hand, did not marry that many men. She had a lot of lovers. And she was not a slut. She had 2 kids for my grandfather. And after that, she said she could not take any nonsense from any other man. So I did not grow up with women who I felt any need to lower my masculinity around. I grew up with people who understood, because I have 5 brothers. I have 3 sons. So I know guys, I know men, and I love them. And I don't feel that I need to make excuses about that. But as I have started to write my plays and everything else, I'm writing a novel at the moment in a female voice. It's first person female voice. And it's extraordinarily challenging for me. I'm discovering things about myself. So it's about actually how do you use something effectively? How do you explore it? And I don't think that any of us, there's anybody that does not have a male side or a female side if you want to tackle that way. So I like to explore the spectrum. But essentially, what I try to do either in my nonfiction or my fiction work on plays is to try to disrupt complacency, is to try to explore possibilities. So I call myself a hope dealer. And on Africa, which is my first love, I'm always excited to see a unique African perspective, to discover a new story, and to engage a new reality. Thank you.
Hello. Working? Yes, thank you for coming, and it's wonderful to be here at the Pen Festival. What I want to say is that I was born in Paris and raised in Abidjan, in Côte d'Ivoire, West Africa. And so traveling has been part of my makeup. Traveling is what defines me almost. And there's a lot of traveling in my work. To the extent that I can see that traveling for me is writing, and writing is about traveling as well. And I'm interested in traveling because each time I travel, I have the impression that I'm rediscovering the world and rediscovering myself. I have traveled extensively in Africa, 3 years in Lagos, 3 years in Kenya, and 14 years in South Africa. So I consider myself as a Pan-Africanist, and I want to continue to explore more the continent, but I have also been to Europe and to the US. What I want to say is that I think that I am a woman before I'm a writer, in the sense that even if I stopped writing, I'll still be a woman. And this has definitely informed my work, because I have this idea that we're all looking at the world from our window. And there's no way that this cannot have an influence on the work. But what I can say is that I have been a woman writer in many different circumstances. So that also has influenced my work. But I'm not just that. I think I'm many other things. I'm an academic. I'm a visual artist. And I also have a production of books for children. And what I can add is that as an African writer, we have a particular dilemma, is that we need to be in tune with what is happening in the whole world. But at the same time, in terms of readership, we really need to work at developing a readership on the continent. And I think that once that happens, because I think, you know, Lola, I know you are very active as well in that domain, but once that happens, then I think we'll have more weight. At the moment, I think we are a bit fragile because we don't have that strong readership behind us yet. And one other thing that concerns me a lot is to try and bridge the gap between Anglophone and Francophone Africa. I think that we're not communicating enough, we're not sharing enough ideas. So that's also part of my traveling and trying to discover the continent as much as possible. But at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here, and thanks to your panel of voices. It's really wonderful to be on this panel with these terrific writers. So I would identify myself as a novelist. I've written 3 books. The most recent is The Distant Marvels with Europa, which has a real international presence. I identify also as Cuban American. I was born in South Florida, in Miami, which is a very sort of Cuban city, and a Cuban family with relatives who were, some of them consider themselves immigrants, others exiles. And so this was where I was raised, in this bilingual household. But when I first started thinking of myself as a writer at a young age, and I suspect a lot of us did, I wasn't thinking about the places where my family came from and where I came from. When I first started writing, I wrote about my stepfather's family in upstate New York. and he grew up in Watertown, New York, was my stepdad. Irish-American, his father collected Balik China and fought in World War II and had a Purple Heart. And I thought to myself, well, that is the stuff that literature is made of. It's made of these stories, right? These white, sort of waspy stories. Like, that is literature, because the truth was, it's all I read. And even though I've grown up in Miami, which is a very international city, my entire sort of reading upbringing had been just very monochromatic. And so when I first started writing in college, I was writing stories about upstate New York. And, you know, Christmas trees that grow out of the ground, I was fascinated. I've never seen pine trees in real life, you know, in Miami or snow. And then one day I walked into a bookstore, and this was a bookstore in the mall, Adults and Books, back when malls had bookstores, the earth was still cooling. And I walked into Adults and Books, and there was this beautiful book on the shelf, and it was Dreaming in Cuban by Cristina Garcia, which I'm sure many of you have read. It's a beautiful novel. And I sort of stumbled towards it, and I opened it up, and I said, my first thought was, who let her get away with this, right? Who is this? And it opens with an older woman sitting at the shore in Cuba and sort of looking out to the sea. And there's Spanish in the book. And the characters very quickly became people that I knew. Like, these were people who could have existed in my family as well. And I've told the story many times, but I always say that it was like every window in my imagination blew open. Because suddenly I realized that the places I had come from, that the places my family had come from, were worthy of art. And what I hadn't known up until that point was that I'd been operating under a ceiling of limited possibilities. The ceiling was here, and I did not know it, right? And so once I discovered that book, I discovered so many others. I discovered Borges, Julio Alvarez, and on and on. And where I thought there had not been pavement for me to walk on, I suddenly realized there had been pavement. I just didn't know where it was, right? And so my fiction from there on sort of exploded, right? And so my books are about Cuban families on the island and in the United States. Very often, women are the center of the story because I grew up in a family full of women. With a grandmother who's a terrific storyteller, so she's very present in those pages. And I don't think I'll ever stop, you know, telling those stories.
You know, I grew up, as I mentioned, in Knoxville, Tennessee, and I was raised also by storytellers and in a strong storytelling tradition. So I come by my interest in storytelling, honest, as they say, in that way, and decided to pursue it as a profession, as have we all. But I received mixed messages, you know, on this path to education, to preparing myself and practicing, you know, and being a writer. On one hand, you know, my African American family, you know, education was everything. You know, expressing yourself as everything, you know, participating in church and making the speech at Easter, you know, was important. You know, that was my first speech, you know, at 7. And participating in the plays and again, you know, making good grades and then getting a byline in the literary journal. But I also received the messages that it's not too good to be too smart if you're a woman. You know, the woman who got the title of being the most intelligent of my many aunts and uncles was the one who was insane. And when I asked what happened to Aunt Addie, it was always, she was so I want you to talk about this, a little bit about how you became a writer and how your background, gender, geography, religion, culture helped in that, and maybe did the opposite, didn't help in that.
Yeah, it did both. I mean, I come from a family where we were three daughters, and I was, as I said, born in a very small plantation village in Mauritius. And luckily, I must say that my parents loved to read. And there's a wonderful story that I tell about them. It's that when my mother got married when she was 16, so she was very frail, so she hadn't been to school that much, so she hardly read at all. But my father was an avid reader. And so when they had just got married, my father would go to the capital city and buy books and bring them home. So at night, when she had finished all her chores at home, he would read to her, and he loved sort of thrillers and whodunits, you know, the Agatha Christie type of books. So he would read the books aloud, and just when it would come at a point where you really want to know what's going to happen, he would say, you know, I'm feeling very sleepy now, so I'm going. And she would beg him to go on one more page, and he would just stop because he was sort of teasing her, basically. So one day when he was out, he had sugarcane plantations, so he was out all day. And she went back to her room and she looked at the book and she really wanted to know what happened. And of course she had been a little bit at school, so she had the letters, and she started deciphering them, and suddenly she realized she could understand what was happening. And she read the book, you know, she finished the book. So when he came back, she said, well, you know, I don't need you to read to me now, I know the story. And from then on, she never stopped reading. She was reading constantly. So I grew up in that kind of environment where at the same time, the village around us wasn't sort of extremely sort of literary, but it was an agricultural village. But at home, we had books and all sorts of books. And of course, at that time, there wasn't television, there wasn't radio. Well, there was radio, but no, nothing else. So. My sisters and myself basically grew up without our source of joy was reading, and so I think writing came almost as a natural growth out of the reading. And my parents were also storytellers, so my mother used to say sort of tell oral stories from sort of originally from India. My father would read books of fairy tales, from Grimm's fairy tales, and both these two sort of domains of fairy tales and myths and the great mythologies became really merged for me. I mean, it sort of really nourished the wish to tell stories through the use of myths, through the use of sort of a bit supernatural, but not quite. So all my stories are a bit sort of on the cusp of these two aspects, reality and this sort of other reality. And I think that as girls, I mean, as I said, we were lucky that our parents were really keen on our being educated, because in the society at large, when people knew that they had three daughters, they would say, oh, I'm so sorry, you don't have the son, you know, just three daughters. But then slowly they started realizing that, you know, the daughters were quite intelligent, as you said. And one thing also that I have to say about my father is that when we grew up and all his daughters were doing very well and being very creative, people would ask him, oh, how come you have such three sort of accomplished daughters? And he would say, they take after their mother. So within the family circle, this creativity was nurtured. Outside it was very different, because obviously you had to sort of fight to be heard. I mean, women's voices were not really heard. And that's something that I've continued to feel even now after more than 40 years of writing, that we still find it hard to be heard. And women cannot sort of find it easy to take the word or really sort of find it how would I say that to own the la parole, you know, to own the act of speaking out. Not everybody, but some of them. And I've realized writing my stories with the same eye for my narrators, for the women, most of them to be able to say what they have to say, they're either mad or they're mute and everything is going on in their head. So there's always some kind of different way to be heard. And once when I was writing from the point of view of a male, I suddenly realized that I didn't have to find any kind of subterfuge to get his voice heard. He from the start, it was his voice, it was there, he didn't have to find any excuse to talk and to be heard. So, well, I let the others talk, but, you know, all these things come together, and I think it's a huge issue still today about this voice of women all over the world.
I have 5 brothers, and I'm the last, and they kind of drove me insane. But I also went to boarding school when I was 6 years old, and I had to read. We had to read for an hour every day, and I grew to love reading, love books. At home, during the holidays, I remember that my dad would ask all the kids to come and sit around the table at dinner, after dinner, and we'd all have to read from this really thick novel. I think it was called The American Heiress or something. Heiress. I've tried to actually look for that novel. I don't know where he got it. I don't know how come we had 8 copies, but everyone had to read from that book. And my brothers hated it. They hated having to go through that. But I thought it was quite enjoyable, and I did it, especially because I think I read much better than any of them did. To go back very quickly into the sort of subject matter and what's important to me as an author, when I was, I have to say that I think my parents were rather confused in that they didn't really know what to do with me as a girl. So I did everything that my brothers did, everything. I was never made to believe that I was inferior to them, except when my mother would say, close your legs, which, you know, I didn't particularly like doing, but I learned to do it eventually. But apart from that, I did everything. I stayed up late, I climbed trees, I was terribly untidy, and they just kind of let me be that girl. And it wasn't until I was about 12 when I started developing mammary glands and breasts that I think one day my mom looked at me and said, what's that? Let's go to the market and buy a bra. So it's things like that. But also, I remember I saw this photograph in a newspaper. I was obsessed with obituaries. I used to read them, or every newspaper, I would read all the obituaries. I loved the language and the photographs. But on the other, so I was reading this obituary, then on the other side, I saw this picture of a man with 3 women, all dressed alike, resplendent, but dressed identically. I mean, everything, all the jewelry, all the, so I read, it was actually Obate Joshua. And he would know, he's Nigerian, so he knows who this person was at the time. And I thought to myself, this is amazing. So I called my mom and I said, look at this. This man has 3 wives. This is what I want to do. Because I could have, you know, all these women. We could go shopping together. We could cook together. This looks like it could be fun. And I will never forget the look my mother gave me that day. She called me into her room and she gave me a talking to. And it was a real turning point, even in my life as a young lady, as a Nigerian, and getting to grips with what it meant to be a woman. And both my parents were born into polygamous families. So she then started to explain to me that, look, these women, they look happy. They look like they're having a good time, yeah? but actually they're not, because this and this and this is what goes on. These women are being forced into a situation where they have to compete with each other, and that's the worst thing that can happen to a woman. And she told me about her own mother, who was the first wife. My grandparents were both traveling teachers, well-educated and all that, but when my grandfather, this is on my mother's side, when my grandfather's father died, he was a king. My grandfather was then invited to come and take over and become the new king. And within 2 years, he had taken on a second wife. Within 5 years, he'd taken on a third. And my grandmother was so horrified by this, and she was unhappy. I didn't see her smiling a whole lot. And every time, and this is even after my grandfather died, every time she would have a conversation with my mom, she would say akuntukwe, which means when he dies, he's dead now and he's gone to hell, but even when he gets to hell, he must die again. So I kind of started thinking to myself, what is all this about? You know, what's going on with all these women? You know, why is it that they find themselves in these situations? Why on earth would any woman want to become a man's second wife? Why would you want to do that to another woman? And so all these things started sort of buzzing around in my head. And I think with my poetry, with my fiction, it's always been about interrogating the place of the woman within my culture, especially on my continent, and of course how they negotiate these spaces that they find themselves in, and how culture sometimes continues to suppress and to oppress them. These are the things that interest me.
Okay, as usual, I'm going to stand a little bit outside. By the way, there, amongst the Igbos, there is a story of a woman who became a king, and she had many wives. This is a very interesting story. Yeah, and she had many wives. And it's actually a published book by women wives. And also there is polyamory in Nigeria as well, in other parts of Nigeria. But the issue is my whole take, or my life, is about complexity. And I resent the need to simplify it for anybody. So I grew up, as indicated, I grew up in a Muslim family. And I grew up, my father never married two wives at the same time. So he had a first wife, that broke up, divorced, and then married my mother. We grew up with about 50 people in the same house, because my parents, after taking on my grandfather's kids after he died, my mom would go driving to our shop and she'll pick up a kid on the street side, bring him home. My brother would go to school and bring someone home, and they'll live with us for 10 years. So we kind of grew up in a place where you had all different kinds of people. And the principle was that nobody knew who was whose father or who was whose mother. The head of the family was the head of the family. You didn't have to be blood and all of that. So on one level, that seemed to be an exciting existence. But on the other, I never got along with my mother. We were very antagonistic to each other, till she died. She died at 38. And I remember the last time I saw her, we still had one massive row. And the row was usually about the fact, I think there was an underlying comment. I have my auntie, our only sister, is albino, but she doesn't look albino. And there is a colorism in most societies. There's a colorism in our own family. She was our father's favorite. And I think there was a subtle amount of that in our relationship.
Was that a unique, she was the father's favorite, was that unique in your environment, or because albinos are not?
They're not unique, but I actually know that in my family, and I know that in other families, but I can't generalize too much. But what I would say, however, was that my mother got married at 18 because she wanted to become a doctor. But she got married at 18 because getting married, that meant something for my grandfather to be able to send his favorite daughter to England to become a doctor. So there was always this kind of tensions in my family. And when my mother always always had this obsession about becoming a doctor. Even though she was now somebody who was now married after leaving secondary school. So she used to buy books. Medical encyclopedia, she'd throw parties to invite surgeons to sit next to us and she could talk about surgery. And she had a bookshop, she had a supermarket with loads of books. So we always had books around. She always had these kinds of incredible conversations. And she knew what was what disease, you know, all these kinds of crazy conversations as a child. So I inherited some interest in books. Firstly, comics, because she had so many comics. She bought and sold comics. And when we eventually found out that she wasn't selling most of the books, we would read them. We'd read the comics and all of that. But going back to the issue of complexity, at the root of everything that I have come to love is the issue of authenticity and complexity. And the ability to explore that without actually leaving one but on the side. I tend to view a lot of my kitchen, which is Western, about dichotomy, which is false to me. Things are never absolutely good or absolutely bad. It's the spectrum in between, exploring that and engaging that. And that was what started to drag me into writing. Then I lived in a small town in the UK called Gloucester. And I lived in Gloucester. I moved to Gloucester almost by accident. And I'm this 6'2" tall black guy. And it was not convenient for me to express my anger. It was not accepted. I had to. Kind of a friend of mine from Sweden used to always say to me, you don't have to raise your voice because just you standing up is enough for your voice to be amplified. So I initially went through a process where I used to apologize even before I spoke. You know, I'm sorry. And then I found that there was a bunching of a lot of anger, a lot of restraint for that. And so it was liberating to be able to communicate in a different way and to start to explore the different expressions of myself as an African, as a man, as an angry man from time to time, as a father, as my mother's son, you know, so that having to write about these things, exploring these things authentically, gave me a voice and a space to do it without people getting frightened. And occasionally they do get frightened by what I write, but that's a different thing. So that was my own freedom, that was my space to express myself, and that is something I hold on to very dearly.
I lived in a household where my mother was an artist. She was a painter, and then she became a sculptor, and she was doing iron kind of sculpture, not feminine at all. It was very, very strong and very close to the earth, what she was doing. So I grew up watching her doing her art, so it became something that for me was natural, that art was something that was a way of expressing yourself that was very valid. I think she told me that. And on my father's side, I would always see him writing long reports. I mean, he was forever in his office writing, very late. And he was also very involved in his community, extremely involved in his community. Streams of people coming to the house, and, you know, with good and bad consequences for his pocket. But anyway, he was very, very involved and also involved in the political environment. So I got that from him, like this idea of really being part of your society and trying to do something for your society. So that's what I got from both my parents. In terms of polygamy, there was no polygamy in our household. It was a monogamous marriage, but 40 years. Huh? But years later, I have the pleasure of saying that I have 7 brothers and sisters whom I didn't know anything about. Yes, and it's an absolutely typical thing of discovering this at the burial. Yeah. 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 In the funerals. Knock. We would like to tell you that. Yeah, sort of thing. inheritance, heritage, and I know that if you say that you love somebody or you love your country, then know that there will be some good and some bad. And the idea is to negotiate and to find some sort of balance so that we can live together again. Because in fact, with the discovery of the children, the family was in the process of imploding. It was like a question of, it was almost on the verge of destruction. And it's that way that I can link it with what happened to Ivory Coast and to the Civil War and to the idea that there's something very hard at the heart of the country or at the heart of somebody you thought you loved and knew. And then you have to find a solution so that you can survive at the family level, but at the national level as well. So in the latest, in my latest novel, that's what I'm trying to do. And the title is Far From My Father. It's this idea that somebody you thought was so close to you, and you thought that the love was for granted, you need to relook at it completely and find another way of, another exit, finding something to construct. And I must say, today, I'm happy I have those brothers and sisters. It's difficult because we never knew each other before, so we had to start from nothing, from scratch. But today I can say both my parents are gone, but I'm not alone. I mean, I'm working on those relationships, even if they're difficult. So I think it's, it taught me a lot. It taught me a lot about who you think you know and what you expected from someone and what you got and how you can survive. Yes.
You and I can bond over discovering about brothers during funerals a little bit later. So it's a common story.
Yeah.
But taking it back to gender, those questions of gender, I was the first person, more than the first generation in my family to go to college. But I did not go away to college. I commuted. I went to the university sort of in the city where I live. Neither I nor my cousins nor any of my friends who were female and Cuban were allowed to go away to college. Because that was for American girls, because their parents don't love them. And they don't care what happens to them. And you better have one of these on your finger before you leave your house, you know? And so I remember getting Facebooks, you know, Facebook catalogs. When you're in 11th grade, and just ditching them because I wasn't going to these places, but I kept the Mount Holyoke catalog for a very long time. I sort of wore it down because it represented for me something I could not have. And so education was important in my family, and they were excited when I said that I had written a story or written a book, though there seems to be a very sort of fundamental misunderstanding about what it means to publish a novel. When I first published my first novel, my grandmother asked me how much I paid for it. And I said, oh no, it's fantastic, they paid me. And she said, are you sure? You know? Because, you know, how would I, little old me, how would I know these things, you know? But for me, those sort of living in this sort of community that so treasures their girls, that I do sort of see it as sort of treasuring their daughters. And particularly for Cubans, it's a traumatized community, right? It's a community that's been forced, that's been divided for over 50 years now. And at least for my family, I would see every year the relatives coming from the island and the sacrifices it took to get them here and cousins who hoarded food and that kind of thing. And for my grandmother and my mother saying it took so long for us all to get together that for me or for my cousins to say, and now we're gonna go away to college, now we're gonna go to Mount Holyoke, would be a slap in the face. Like, we are all together now, and you're gonna leave? How dare you, right? It's that kind of thing, you know? And so I have great empathy for that community that still does that to its girls in many respects. But for me, having now not lived at home for a long time, and sort of seeing the world, when I write my books, I either write about characters who are female and are feeling that enclosure and are bucking against it, or in my most recent book, I have a a warrior character. It's the Cuban Revolution, 19th century, and she is determined to get a machete and fight with the men, you know? And so in a way, I'm sort of writing against this thing, which I don't feel like I was punished, I don't feel like I was traumatized, I don't feel any of that. I felt loved. I felt deeply, deeply loved. But I always think about what could have been. What if I had gone to Manolio? You know, who would I be now and would I be different? And would I have lost something in the process or gained something? So.
Well, you speak to the Okay, yeah, time's getting short, so I'm going to bring the audience in. But I do want to say that the role of the writer is to explode stereotypes and to decide what to reveal and what to conceal, you know. And in my opinion, I mean, art is about being brave and really revealing as much as possible, including the complex truths. Like, it's not black or white, it's not binary, it's not just male and female. We know the gender is not, you know, just this or that anymore. I mean, we've grown and our whole vocabulary about gender has expanded. And I think also we need to grow in our discussion of what traditional practices gave us, the good and the negative. We have polygamy too, you know, we just don't call it polygamy. You know what I mean? It's more like you discover sooner or later that, you know, you have siblings and family and, you know, all this kind of thing. In the South, it's people living in the compounds still. It's a financial necessity because you're cash poor, but your land rich. You know, that kind of thing. There's the issue of geography, you know, urban life versus rural life. But I do want to open this up for questions, let you guys participate. Yes, sir.
So my question was to the panel, has there been a piece of art, book, movie, sculpture that helped you in your development of how you think about gender? Because for me, it was Roxana by Danny Defoe, because I didn't understand until I read that book in college the impact that marriage has on a woman's options to function. So that's, you can mention if you recommend anything that, like, I read this or I saw this and I'm like, wow, that really, like, changed me.
Well, I can talk about Walter Mosley, who's my favorite writer. And there's a particular book, I can't remember the name, I think it's Red Blondie or something like that.
The one in the blue dress?
No. It wasn't one of the detective series that he writes. And I remember crying for about a week. Just every time I picked up the book, I burst into tears because here was he exploring the vulnerability of men and actually also challenging the fact that men in some ways should not engage the warrior inside them. It's dangerous. So he was able to, for me anyway, legitimize the complexity of the male and moving away from the strong man. And not in a way that talks about victimhood or anything else, of course. I mean, we know about the history of men and what we have done, but essentially making it legitimate for people to play with masculinity, which I think is a critical issue today, whether you're talking about Daesh, you're talking about Al-Qaeda, whatever you're talking about. I genuinely believe that it's a crisis of masculinity and that we need to start exploring different ways of masculinity. Now you become a man, you know, becoming a man, rather than just an adult male. You can need to be knighted and be an adult male and never become a man. So what is that? What does it mean? And exploring the complex man. So Walter Mosley in his books does that.
Anyone else?
Yeah.
Hi, my name is I'd like to say, well, again, coming back to my mother telling us about mythological, Hindu mythological stories, there's one very well-known epic book and poem called Ramayana. And for Hindus, the main character is Rama, who is sort of supposed to be an incarnation of God. And in that story, his wife gets kidnapped by a demon king. And he keeps the wife, the demon king keeps the wife for several months. And there's a big war, and Rama goes and rescues his wife, kills the demon king, and brings her back to his kingdom. But then under the pressure of his people who say, well, this woman has lived in the palace of this demon king, how do we know she's still faithful, she's still pure? And in order to satisfy the queries of his people, he asks her to go through a ritual called the Agni Pariksha, which is you have to go through fire, and if you are pure, you get out of it unburned. Well, this myth has been used by Hindus for centuries to show the purity of the Hindu woman. So this woman called Sita is a sort of an example of what Indian women should be. But when my mother told us this story when I was very small, she gave it a completely different bent, because she kept saying to us, well, you see, in fact, why did Rama have to give in first to his people's request to test this woman? If he really loved her, he could have trusted her. Why did he go push her through this terrible ritual? And also she stressed that when the wife accepts to go through the ritual, she comes out unburnt, but then she leaves him. She goes away and goes to the forest. And this part of the story is never told. You know, it always ends with she coming out pure and everything. So in fact, it was this kind of feminist approach that my mother gave to these stories. That in a way made me look at them in a different way and see that these women were very strong, but the way that the men had interpreted these books, which were supposed to be sacred books, had completely changed the way that they looked at women. And even today, the way Indian men look at Indian women, if they're not sort of, you know, if they show a bit of a different way of an independence or going out at night alone or, you know, that sort of thing, they think it's an invitation for rape, basically. So, and this hasn't changed. I mean, this epic was written 4,000 years ago, and today we still have stories of men having that same. So I think there is a crisis of masculinity, but there's also an absolute absence of change, you know, not just a crisis, there's no change in many parts of the world, including here, and the way they think about women. And I've seen there's recently been in England or maybe here, a sort of campaign where women are dressed, there's photographs of women dressed even in short dresses or sort of low-cut blouses, and they say, this doesn't mean yes, you know. So, and you still hear this today, that, oh, okay, if she's wearing a short skirt, or, then it means that she's asking for it.
Can I respond a little bit?
Sure.
And that's the problem. So, for example, there is really a conversation about sex and what it really means. Mm-hmm. And the question of sex as intimacy rather than possession, and how you actually help boys to understand that it's an intimate process, it's a vulnerable process, it is not about possession, and how to start to have that conversation in real time, so rather than expect people to just going to be becoming a man. There are so many things that need to be thought about what it takes, and you cannot be a man if you don't become a woman in some ways. You have to really learn.
Yeah, I want to rebound on that. Is that when I read when I wrote my first book, it was like kind of not autobiographical, but so as the crow flies. I had no problem. I knew what I was, who my character was. But the second book, I remember I was like playing with the characters, and then suddenly there was this character who was a man, and I was happily continuing to write, and then I said, it doesn't work, because this character should be something else, should be a woman. It should be, and it's happened to have been an old woman with a lot of power in terms of traditions. And she was passing on that that tradition to a much younger woman in the book. And the moment I discovered that I was by default, as you said, putting power into male characters, it changed completely. And then I started looking at the powerful characters in our myths. And that's where I fell in love with Baniwata. And she's all over. You know, she's in the books for adults, she's in the books for children. Then I rediscovered Queen Poku. And finally I said, we have all these powerful women who were queens and who did amazing things, not counting the Amazons and etc. And so that really fed my my work, and I realized how much I was like formatted to give the power first to the man. And so I must say it wasn't natural. It wasn't something natural. I had to have some sort of awareness of what I was doing without thinking. And that completely changed my writing.
Yeah, I would like for you, if there's not another question, I would like for you to talk a little bit more about Queen Poku and how you rewrite the story in one volume, so to speak. You go in and out of what the legend is and maybe say, you know, what it is.
The thing about a figure like Queen Poku, who really existed, by the way, and that's what is fascinating, is that you find her trace in history. She has existed. She left Ghana and then founded the kingdom of the Baole kingdom in Côte d'Ivoire. So she existed. But what is interesting is that she has the status of a mythical figure. Therefore, you know, the story is formatted by men. And when I knew I grew up with the story, but after a while and after the event in Ivory Coast, I decided to look at her differently. That means from a woman's point of view. And what was happening to the story was that she is supposed to, she sacrificed her child in order to save her people. But she never talks. She was a mute character. And I said, I am a woman, I have children, this woman must have suffered the hell to do that sacrifice. And I decided to give her voice back. I am going to give her a voice back as a woman, and what made her do that kind of sacrifice, which is inconceivable. So in fact, it's a questioning of tradition, traditional myth, and I think that our jobs probably as writers is to look at some of the kind of propaganda and question it. Because if we don't do it, then we take the modern propaganda as well. Because very often political people use our myths to inform the present. And that's dangerous. So it was important as a woman to relook at that myth and really give it a feminine dimension.
Right, and you did. There will be a book signing in a few minutes. Our time is wrapping up. But Chantel, do you have any last comment to make?
I don't know, I was just so stunned with what everyone just said. I was just sitting here like nodding like this, you know, but I think you're right. I think you mentioned earlier that, you know, authors write against stereotype. Sometimes we write, if you're doing it thoughtfully, you're writing, if you're creating characters that fit a kind of stereotype, you're doing it very purposely. In other words, to show it's not, right? Like this is like writing against that propaganda, as you said, you know? And so I think it's sort of knowing our stories, and sort of seeing those gaps, seeing those places where perhaps a kind of narrative justice is necessary because the world has not imparted justice on those characters or on those voices or on those historical figures. Where are the silences? And how can we fill those silences? I think those are very interesting questions for me too. So.
let me encourage you guys to read these writers if you haven't already, and the work that you have read of them, you know, continue on. Because, you know, as I say, I have been enriched by this experience, engaging with your work and now engaging with them, and buy books downstairs and get them signed, you know, while we can. But thank you very much for being a great and attentive audience.